Times. Next one is Ahmed Atel Asidu. The end of globalization as we knew it, perspectives for Balkan countries.
Hello everybody. Thank you for the invitation. I would like to thank the organizers of this event. Let me briefly introduce myself. I am Ahmed. I'm from Istanbul, from Greens and Left for the Future Party. I'm also co-chairing the Balkan Network, this European Green Party Balkan Network with older people. And once more, I'd like to thank the Green Institute of Greece for their unconditional support for this network. I am also, I'm an economist, sorry for that. I'm working as an assistant professor at the Istanbul Technical University. I'm teaching macroeconomics courses. So when I first received the invitation of this event on ecopopulism, political ecology and Balkans, what popped up in my brain might actually, you know, the linkage between the crisis and the rising nationalism, the fascism. I mean, I'm not a political scientist, and forgive me if I'm too reductionist or oversimplifying, I mean, if I oversimplify the thing, but for me, populism, what I understood, my understanding of populism is actually is nationalism, fascism, right? The negative side, I mean, mostly. So, of course, but this understanding actually, when you view the populism like this, my intent was to kind of draw the similarities of today and the past. Of course, we are now living in a crisis, right? It's, for me, it is, I mean, many view this crisis as a triple crisis, the economical crisis, social crisis, and the ecological crisis. And it has very common elements with the Great Depression of 1930s. From this point of view, actually, maybe history can help us to find our way out of this crisis. So this is what I'm going to do. Just critically analyze the response given by European Union to the ongoing crisis and the possible dangers, threats. As actually, I would like to talk about the recent development taking place. This is the free trade agreement between European Union and United States. So, as you may have heard, European Union is pressing hard to sign a free trade agreement with United States in order to recover from the economic crisis. Right? It's based on the all believe that trade is good if we, you know, if we open for international trade, we'll start to produce more, unemployment decrease, and blah blah blah. So I think it poses a real danger to our world. And I'd like to explain why. First of all, signing this kind of bilateral free trade agreement is by definition not multilateral. It's not based on the cooperative solution of the country. It's very risky that the countries are forced to lower down their environmental and labor standards, the so-called race to the bottom phenomena. So, for me, in the short run, it may help to revive the economy in Europe, but in the long run, it's not a sustainable way out of the crisis. Simply because it may provoke retaliation elsewhere, and this is what we have experienced right after the Great Depression in 1930s. We need to find a cooperative solution. I mean, the crisis is we have global problems that need to be tackled in a cooperative manner. That's the first thing I want to make. So, for me, the right answer is the Green New Deal, right? This is the kind of only, for me, it's the only way out of this crisis. And let me go back to the history. What happened in the 1930s and how we overcome the crisis? I know that I am too oversimplifying the things, but this is how Karl Polanyi, the famous thinker, saw the developments taking place in 1930. So, in the world, broadly speaking, there were three proposals, or let's say three policy sets offered to overcome the crisis. Bolshevism in the, you know, the Eastern Europe, and Nazism in Germany, in Italy, as you all know, and the development of the social state, the welfare state, first started in United States with the New Deal program of Roosevelt in 1930s, and then it spread to continental Europe and elsewhere in the world. And if you look at it critically, only the New Deal survived. Neither Nazism, Fascism, nor Bolshevism managed to get the people out of misery. They led to more misery in one way or another. Only the New Deal, the welfare state, actually worked and provided a peaceful way out of the crisis. So, I mean, dynamics is simple, actually. So it's like a vicious circle, right? This is what we are now experiencing in Greece, in Spain, in Italy, the economic crisis, misery, frustration of people, unemployment, social unrest, which led to the rising of nationalistic parties, right-wing parties. It's a very fertile, it provided a very fertile ground for right-wing parties to flourish this times of economic crisis, as you all know. And then those right-wing parties comes up with some popular measures to overcome the crisis, oversimplified, right? The protectionism, anti-immigrant laws, Greece for Greeks, you know, this kind of slogans, policies, they actually, or the rising protectionism, leaving the euro, leaving the European Union, go back to Drahma, this kind of measures actually is a very short-sighted policies, but turn out to be very appealing to people. They provoke retaliation, right? And they aggravate conflicts within the society, and then the vicious circle actually closed with more misery. So we need to kind of, break this vicious circle to find a sustainable way. So for me, international solidarity is important. This is what we are lacking in these days, inside Europe and throughout the world. If you look at the way to the Second World War, the rising Nazism in Germany, you see the elements now we are experiencing today. Right, the currency wars, tariff wars, to export the crisis elsewhere. This is what we call as beggar tie neighbor policies in economics jargon. Right? But then it led to the Second World War, 50 million people killed. After all this catastrophe, let's say, the world came to an understanding of, we need to found an international system in order to solve our problems. This is the international institutional setting of post-World War II during the Bretton Woods conference in 1944. Those, if you look at the vision of the international organizations like the Bretton Woods institutions, like the IMF, World Bank, and WTO, World Trade Organization, the vision is simple, although it changed a lot in the last couple of decades. The idea was to provide appropriate platforms to sort out problems in a peaceful and cooperative manner. I think it's very important to keep this in mind. And it was successful. If you look at the the 1950s, 1960s were called the golden age of capitalism, and the people, the rising of the welfare state, it worked, and the mechanism provided thanks to the mechanisms provided by these Bretton Woods institutions. But these institutions actually undermined, or this international solidarity is undermined by the neoliberal attacks since 1980s, as you all know. So, first of all, we need to, describe the consequences of the economic globalization in the neoliberal sense. That's what I refer to as the developments taken place since 1980s. We experienced the second wave of globalization, right? And if you analyze this, let's say the path we followed since 1980s, We saw the transformation of the world economic system. Once fairly resilient and self-sustaining local economies became gradually the small and fragile parts of the global supply chain. The globalization developed by killing the local economies. I think it's very important to note this point. And hopefully the 2008 crisis proved that global economy cannot be sustained at the expense of local economy. So we need to, I mean, it's not, I'm not against globalization, right? I mean, I'm not in favor of protectionism. No, but the question is that by killing the local economies, you cannot build a global economy. This is what we need to consider. So, solution, whether more trade, we need more trade or less trade. If you look at the plan of EU with this free trade agreement, the path we are taking is actually more trade. But I don't think that it will solve our problems, more trade. First of all, it's not a cooperative solution, as I mentioned. We have the global problems. If we want to increase the trade and in order to solve our economic problems, Doha Round, this multilateral trade agreement framework, I think, is the one we need to stick to, not the bilateral free trade agreements. Because these bilateral agreements are not transparent and not democratic. In the multilateral trade agreements, the actors are state to state. But in the bilateral trade agreements, firms and states, firms and governments. And if you look at the recent experiences of the NAFTA, North American Free Trade Area, a lot of Latin American governments actually were sued by the US multinational firms on international courts. They were kind of forced to pay billions of dollars to US companies because there's no state-to-state dispute resolution mechanism. It's the firm. So, for me, the answer is the, whatever you call it, Green New Deal or green economy or green transformation. We need to transform our economies on a more sustainable manner. This is important for peace and prosperity in the world. This short-sighted, short-run solutions to the economic crisis is not sustainable. We saw that they didn't work in the past. They led to more misery. So there's no point of repeating the same mistakes today. This is the main message I would like to give, actually. So, of course, it's very complicated and becoming more complicated as they pass. How to convince the governments, how to convince the countries around the globe to come together and find cooperative solutions. But we have no other option. One way or another, we need to find manage that, actually. So, I'd like to thank for your attention.